Hello everyone and welcome to EBTV. It is my pleasure today to welcome Dr. Stephen Farmer as a featured guest on the show. Dr. Farmer, hello and welcome.
Well, thank you. Thank you, Evita, for having me on your show. Looking forward to it.
You're very welcome. And for anyone who may be new, for example, to your work and the topics that we will be covering, I will just give a brief introduction. Dr. Stephen Farmer is a spiritual teacher as well as a soul healer, shamanic practitioner, and author of numerous books, including Heal Your Ancestral Karma, which will be the main focus for our show today. And so, Dr. Farmer, as we get into this topic, of course, you've written on so many other topics when it comes to shamanism, when it comes to really understanding our soul, understanding our even purpose and just how to interact with this reality, even as it relates to nature and animal totems, etc. Of course, one of the things that is so near and dear to every single one of us is, of course, our own life path, as well as the family that we have grown up in. And all too many of us are very familiar with, for example, the various destructive cycles, patterns, and themes that run in our family lineages, such as addiction, such as various forms of abuse, as well as mental illness. And so to help us understand what is ancestral karma all about and how to recognize these patterns and some ideas of how to heal them, how to break these cycles so that we can thrive and bring some peace to not just our own lives, but also all that emanates out from our life through to our ancestors as well. So to get started, Dr. Farmer, can we get first a little bit of an understanding more in depth to your work in terms of how you got started, because your work, of course, began as a psychotherapist, and how you came to do the things you do today?
Oh, my goodness. That would probably take up the whole hour if I got very detailed, but I'll try to encapsulate it. I didn't grow up in a real strong religious environment. One of my favorite stories of my father is that we lived in Iowa, Cedar Rapids, Iowa. That's where I grew up until I was 12. And one of my favorite stories is that when I was 5 years old, is my father came home one Sunday and said, "That's it, we're done with that Baptist church," because he doesn't want us to read the Sunday newspaper. And I love that. I thought, "Yay, Dad, you know, that's cool." So I wasn't heavily indoctrinated. And I think like many people, your listeners included, of course, is that, you know, we've sort of started out on this journey of spiritual exploration, and that really was true for myself. I sampled, I knew at some point in my work I was a healer, I was a psychotherapist, certainly, and I still have my license. It's inactive right now, but I still have my license because there's a ton of stuff that I learned as a therapist. But in addition to the work in therapy, I began my own spiritual exploration by going through various religion/spiritual teachings, Church of Religious Science, about 4 years. It seemed like in 4 year cycles, 4 years of a group called the Emissaries of Divine Light, which actually had one of their centers was in Toronto or near Toronto. And I actually was there for a 3-week process. And then I went to this, something about Canada, I guess. I went to this group in Vancouver that was called Xanthiros. It turned out to be kind of cultic. And I spent about 3-4 years there, and it really did a lot of emotional clearing. I was a pretty hard nut to crack, Evita, in that I think we all grow up in certain circumstances, whatever they are, and we just instinctively adapt to the circumstances we're in, plus we got our own soul's karma, which I'll address as well. It was about 23 years ago that a friend of mine said, "Hey, you should take this 2-day course called Shamanism, presented by the Foundation for Shamanic Studies, which was developed by Michael Harner, an anthropologist, along with his wife Sandra." And he was down in the jungles of Peru and the Amazon in the late 50s, early 60s. And he had an experience with a plant medicine there that really opened him up to a different reality. He was not your usual anthropologist at that time, which was you study a culture, you don't engage, you know, you're not involved. Well, we know that now from physics and experiments, that you can't just purely be an observer. You just can't, you know, you show up in, there's more on that later, but there you show up and you're part of the deal, you know, part of what's going on. Anyway, I took this course, Evita, and I came out of that just 2 days going, this is home. This is my soul work, you could say. I know this is what I'm supposed to be doing now. This is the next cycle. And I'm a little crazy in that way, in a good sense of the word, is when I find something that really speaks to me, speaks to my heart and my soul, it's like I just gobble it up as much as I can. I did that with yoga, you know, a few years before that. I took a couple of yoga classes and I went, oh man, this is cool. So I'm taking two classes a day sometimes. It was crazy. Tai Chi, same thing. I was just avid. And I am obsessive compulsive, and I don't want to call it a disorder because, you know, my life works. But basically, I think when you write books or do anything like that, you have to have that element of obsessiveness. So I became obsessed with shamanism, and I wanted to take it. I was already talking to Michael. I said, can I do the three-year program? And he said, no, you're not ready yet. You need to do some other stuff, blah, blah, blah. So I took Tibet. I studied Tibetan shamanism, Celtic shamanism, Huna. I'm trying to remember. There seems like there was something else there. Oh, I have a good friend, a couple of dear friends that were shamans, that are shamans, that also I would do ceremony with them. Been to Peru myself at least once, probably going to go again at some point. So I just really was doing a lot of gathering in these trainings. And eventually I went, okay, I really am complete with my role as a psychotherapist. You know, there wasn't enough room, you know, to introduce some of the shamanic healing. So that's really where it took off. I slowly, you know, quit my practice. I won't say retired. I don't like the word retired, but I quit the practice and moved more into the shamanic teaching and healing and writing, as you know, and started producing books that were starting. I'd written some books as a therapist, Evita, about four books, one of which, by the way, has been recently updated and reissued after 25 years. I wanted to take these elements, these certain aspects of shamanism that I was learning, and introduce them to a broader audience, if at all possible. So the first book in that genre was Sacred Ceremony. It's like, you know, you don't have to be a shaman or even be interested in shamanic realities to get some good stuff from this book. And then it went on to introducing spirit animals, animal spirit guides, power animals, etc., earth magic, oracle cards, etc. I'm a little astounded sometimes when I think of, God, did I really do all that? But I, you know, I did, and I'm pleased. I can't say proud. I'm just very pleased. The response has been great. People that have come across my works, and it's been valuable to them. So that's as brief as I possibly can be, I think, about my own history. And I would say one more thing about that is I just feel very grateful and very blessed. You know, I would say most of the time, at least, I feel grateful and blessed that I'm able to offer this to the world, to the community, and individuals. As you know, we're at a time of dramatic changes, not only in the earth, but in human consciousness. And as I came across one writing recently, it's like over a period of maybe a few generations, there's a new human that's evolving here, one that in fact is truly intimate and connected and recognizes at a very basic level that we're related to everything on this planet. No exceptions, everything. As many Native American people say, it's about relationship. It's not about this this American ideal, I guess, of the rugged individual. You know, well, we're not. We're not really. We think we are, but we're not really. We're intimately connected. Anyway, that's my story, and I'm sticking to it.
Well, that was beautiful to hear, especially, you know, that I think this again emanates such a beautiful example that you heard a calling, you were open to it, and you followed it. And again, that's such a big part of all of our lives. But so many of us, of course, either are not open to it, or we just shut it down thinking, well, that's not practical or realistic, right? So this serves your story, that is, of course, as a beautiful example to listen, be open, and then, you know, follow that soul path, as you know, your life has shown and your life's work, as we'll be talking too about the soul path in general. And so as we get to understanding our purpose and, of course, our family's involvement, our ancestral involvement, let's start with the word karma, because what I like to do always is share and, you know, start with a foundation, because as we know, we don't all use the same words based on the same meaning. So how do you describe and explain karma?
Sure. In its original meaning, karma meant that as we reincarnate in each lifetime, basically we try to do better and better as we go along, that there is a certain karma we carry with us and that we want to clean it up so that we can go into a, you could say, a better life. That's the original meaning of karma. I've taken that as a description in this sense of healing ancestral karma, the title of the book, is that we, first off, let me back up. I'm also wanting to recast the language of that we typically speak of our those who have come before, our parents, grandparents, etc. Start thinking of them as ancestors. There's a little different twist when you think of them as ancestors. In indigenous communities, and I'm generalizing vastly, but it's really true of everything that I've come across, the ancestors are a living entity daily. In other words, they're around all the time. A friend of mine, Gretchen, I'm going to circle back to talking about ancestral karma, but a friend of mine who's shaman, Gretchen, Caucasian, Irish, you know, Gretchen McKay, I mean, she's got an Irish name, the whole bit. A few years back, came across an African healer named PK, and I hesitate to pronounce his name because I still haven't learned how to pronounce it, but we'll call him PK because he went by those initials. He came to the United States, and I did a reading with him. They do something in the culture called throwing the bones. It's a number of artifacts and how they land, and it tells you all about, but always the ancestors are involved. Anyway, he said something to her in her first meeting with him. He said, "Gretchen, you've lost your ancestors." And he said that very sadly because it was such a foreign concept to him that you don't honor the ancestors. So that's one piece that I think is really important, is to think about not only our progenitors as deceased loved ones, but also as ancestors. And then it opens up a whole different realm of the old ones, the ancient ones, the ones that will traverse back and forth to this planet to help us out. And I got to tell you, from my own experience, my meditations and my shamanic journeys, they really are knocking at the door. They want to help us. And they really do. That's another story, though, is the old ones that want to help us. They're spiritual realities. They're beings that have known what it's like to be a human being. The one being that has been a significant teacher for me, whether true or not, I don't know. It doesn't matter. This is a soul's reality, and it makes sense from that perspective. Told me that he was initially on the earth about 25,000 years ago, and he's come back to help various people. I'm not anything special. He's helped a lot of people as a guide, as a spirit guide, and an ancestral spirit. So that's one thing. Now, bring it back home, though, a little bit closer to home, healing ancestral karma. What is very interesting to me, Evita, at this time in our lives, in the world, really, but I think particularly in Western culture, there's so many opportunities for healing. Mm. There's a science that's emerged in the last, I think, about 25, 30 years called epigenetics. Mm-hmm. And it really settles the question, is it nature or nurture? Well, it's a little of both. I think we've always known that. But also that when we're born with a certain genetic imprint, we can't change the DNA. DNA is, that's it. You know, you've got your color of your eyes, your skin, your hair, your ethnic colorations, etc. But we can change the way that the genes express. And this is being studied quite a bit, and there can be emotional healing, spiritual healing, any number of ways that we might heal the way the genes express themselves. We're not stuck with it. You know, it's not like a passive sort of fatalistic, destiny isn't the right word, but fate.
Yeah.
You know, it's not our fate. I'm evidence of it myself in my own healing process. So that's one thing. So karma, in this sense, really is that thread that runs through from ancestor to ancestor to ancestor down the line, so that we are carrying not only the genetic imprint, but we're carrying the imprint of our ancestors at a soul level too. What is available to us in many ways is healing. There's another, the next piece on this is that it's very, very absolutely 120% clear to me that when we die, we're not done. That there still is, I hate to break the news, you know, you don't get sainted when you die. You know, there's still work to do in the afterlife. And one of the beauties of it is that we can assist our ancestors in evolving through their spiritual path in the afterlife. And in turn, they can help us. I've had some beautiful, beautiful examples of that. Let's say mom or dad, an ancestor, or Uncle Bill, or grandma, grandpa, they come through the medium as a channel and offer some healing to the person who is physically embodied. The other thing is, I'm sure your listeners, some of your listeners, if not all, have had the experience of a deceased loved one who goes into the ancestor world, into the spirit world, and without a professional medium, will appear to them dreams, in a voice, a scent, grandma's perfume, you know, in some way. My brother, who died 20 years ago, up until about 8 years ago, when he would show up, I could tell because it smelled like somebody was smoking, and I'd look around and there's nobody around, so. I went, okay, Wally, is that you? And I could tell he was there. The beauty of this, Evita, is that we can, when we do our healing, which again, we have so many options now for both spiritual and emotional and psychological healing. It's just what an era to live in. You know, we're understanding trauma more and more. I was somewhat of a trauma expert when I was a therapist, and now I have the shamanic and the psychological view. And there's so much trauma in the world, you know, veterans returning from war, childhood trauma, etc. But the good news is that we can work with this trauma. We have tools now, effective ones. Somatic experiencing, which I trained in. EMDR, the eye movement thing that is very effective in treating post-traumatic response. EFT, emotional freedom technique. God, there's a few others too that escape me right now, but we can heal this trauma, and in turn, it extends itself to the afterlife, to those who have come before. So that's a long answer to your question, but that's really what I mean by healing ancestral karma. And as I said earlier, I think that we're moving, you know, generation to generation to a new human being. I was told in a journey meditation about 4 or 5 generations, you know. I remember when I was first writing about this, this is an aside, I said, I can't wait to be an ancestor. And I went, let me be real clear about that. You know, not ready yet, but you know, one of these days I can be an ancestor and come back in that form and sort of watch over my children, my grandchildren, and my great-grandchildren, who I may never see on this physical realm.
And that's great that actually you bring up so many aspects of the ancestors' role in our life and perhaps our role as ancestors in future generations' lives. And something that I think is really interesting to note, and if you could expand on, is in your book, you talk about the 3 types of ancestors, because we're so used to thinking that, oh, it's just who's related to us by blood or DNA. Can you help us understand the 3 types of ancestors and how we're connected?
Good question, and I'm glad you read the book too. Yeah. We typically think of, and rightly so, of our ancestors as our biological, our lineage. And that's what most people think of, and that's really where we're working with as far as our own personal healing. I have more than one story of myself as well as other people that have talked about an ancestor from the immediate 3 mm-hmm. previous generations appearing, and then there's been some healing. A lot of healing with my mother took place that way after she died. It was very interesting because she had come to me on more than one occasion, and there's been a great deal of healing and forgiveness and compassion for her and her compassion for me, etc. So typically we think of biological lineage. There's an interesting facet of that too, Evita, and that's that Jill Bolt Taylor talks about this in this fabulous book called My Stroke of Insight. You can watch her on TED. TED Talks too. She's available on TED Talks, or you can pick up the book. And she, in essence, what happened is that she had a hemorrhage that went on her left brain, and left brain sort of went out the window, but she was having these incredible numinous experiences of unity and vastness and connected to being part of the oneness, etc. But she talked about, she's a neuroscientist. She said that when you look at the genetic coding of us human beings, 99.9% is exactly the same. That blows my mind, Evita. You know, 99.99%. So 0.01% is what differentiates you and me, male from female, from blue eyes to dark eyes to color of hair, et cetera, et cetera. That really speaks to me of this philosophical notion that we really are one. You know, we are related, you know, to all the others in our species. The other facet that interests me about this is that if we go back a certain number of generations, if we go back 10 generations in our biological lineage, we have over 1,000 ancestors. Of course, the gene pool is a little more diffuse then. There's more influences, but we have over 1,000. Go back 20 generations, you got over 1 million ancestors. So again, that speaks to me again of the fact that we are all related, in spite of, you know, the conflicts that we hear about and witness, etc., you know, between us human beings. So that's one type, is biological ancestors, and those are the ones we tend to think of most commonly. Second type, though, is kind of interesting. Not just kind of, it's very interesting, is territorial ancestors. Those are ancestors of the land. One of the things that I think is a problem, why we haven't connected with ancestors and ancestral spirits, is that we don't stay in the same land. You know, we're a highly mobile society, so we don't get really deeply rooted and connected to the same land. Unlike, let's say, the Hawaiians who have been there for centuries, or the Australian Aboriginals that have been there for decades, tens of thousands of years. But if you walk outside, take some deep breaths, take your shoes off, or wear leather sole shoes instead of your tennis shoes, rubber sole, take a few deep breaths and just call in the ancestors of the land and watch what happens. You may see them in your mind's eye, or you might externally see them, get a sense of them on that kind of screen that's in your mind's eye. You might hear them speak to you or sing to you or chant. Or you, what a lot of people do is you just sense their presence. Those are the territorial ancestors. It's very rare in my workshops, Evita, that I go, how many of you live in the same, on the same land that your parents lived? One person, maybe, you know, out of 200. You get my point anyway. We're not as intimately associated with the land, and that's part of the reason that we tend to be disconnected from the intimacy with all beings. The third type, I think, is very fascinating, and some of these can overlap naturally. The biological can overlap with territorial. The third type is spiritual ancestors. And that's that, you know, if you have a draw to a certain culture or a land, like, again, I use the example of my friend Gretchen, who has actually traveled to Africa and was initiated after a couple of visits. She was initiated as a Sangoma, which is, in that particular culture, is a shaman. When she first met PK, the fellow I was referring to earlier, she felt just such a strong draw to that particular land and the people that over the next several years, she started her training with PK, throwing the bones. She actually traveled there, and then eventually, and I saw some pictures of this, her initiation as a Sangoma. And she is now actually the community down the street. I live in Dana Point. She's lives in Laguna Beach. Real sister, you know, real, definitely a soul sister. She's practicing now. PK has since gone to the afterlife, and guess what? She still talks with him. He still talks with her. He has become a spiritual, or has been a spiritual ancestor. If you're drawn to a particular land or a particular culture or peoples, and you're in this vein of understanding ancestors, it's likely that you can find an ancestor there. Now, I'll give you another example, is the didgeridoo. Didgeridoo is an ancient, long-standing Australian Aboriginal instrument, and it's the one that goes that droning sound. I learned to play it. Can't say I play it really well, but I learned to play it about 5 or 6 years ago. And I would there's this thing called circular breathing. which is really where you are taking in air through your nose and continuing to expel it through your mouth to make those kind of sounds. I picked up, I could make sounds pretty well, you know. But it took a while to get the circular breathing. So I talked to a couple of fellows and they gave me some tips on it, but I couldn't quite get it. One day, there's a little side note, I would actually sit in the bathroom and put the digi in the tub, because then it would be really big sound. And I love that when there's that big sound of the didgeridoo. So one day I was practicing and a teacher came in. And I don't know if it's his name or just his a chant, but he gave me this chant, I'll call it, Pieshoku Pieshoka. And my instructions were to do that before I played the didge every time in coordination with the breath. Pieshoka, Pieshoku. And I was instructed to take three breaths like that. And from there on, he started teaching me. And I would hear his voice in my head. And what he'd say are two things. He would say, breathe. Oh yeah, it's all about the breath with the didge. And then the other thing he'd say is, relax. That's all he did. He didn't say, okay, do this, and then when you twist your mouth this way, and then when you breathe, that's it. You know, and it was the greatest teaching in the world. I like simple things like that. Mm-hmm. And then one day, as I was playing or attempting to play and try, suddenly I did it. I could do circular breathing. You know, there was no pause, no gaps. I did this and I went, this is so cool. I got it. So I went to my head, you know, and exclaimed to myself, this is great. And I picked up the didge again and I started and I couldn't do it again. It took another two months before I could recapture that. Anyway, that's a spiritual teacher. Mm-hmm. And that I think, it could be grandpa that's your spiritual teacher. It's very possible, so the two may overlap. But those are the three kinds.
Wonderful. Well, thank you so much for that explanation. As again, it helps us expand our perspective that it's not just, you know, that closest or nearest family unit that we may be thinking of. And you've mentioned also, you know, about, of course, ancestors from the past and, of course, the future. Again, I'll bring up that aspect because one area that I find is always intriguing and ties in here very much is, you know, how we ourselves reincarnate through various lifetimes. And essentially, in a sense, we are our own ancestors too. So how does this come, you know, full circle here, that essentially we are also healing ourselves as our own ancestors?
Yeah, there's, as you probably know from reading the book, there's a couple of stories in there. In fact, Gretchen told a story, and then my friend Jade told a story about going back to meet, let's say Jade's example was taken back to meet this Siberian shaman who taught him several of the shamanic healing methodologies that he had employed. And then at one point discovered that not only was this a teacher in some ancestral way, but it was him. What that does to the conscious mind is it goes, what? That doesn't make sense. How can that be? Because the conscious mind wants to make it either or. Mm-hmm. One of the things I learned years ago in hypnosis is to almost like trick the conscious mind, either or. The subconscious mind can take in both realities. That then becomes what I would like to call a paradox. Both and, not either or. So that's one take on this, is that it can both be oneself as well as oneself embodied in an ancestral spirit. The other piece of this that gets a little, shall we say, abstract, is in physics, that what has been proposed theoretically is that there are actually a number of parallel universes. And this, to me, explains as good as I've come up with as to how can we both reincarnate and at the same time be an ancestor. If we reincarnate again in a physical body, then how can I be that and an ancestor? And again, I think this idea of parallel universes to me is fascinating. And again, it's not something that the conscious mind can necessarily relate to or understand, but at a subconscious level or at a soul level, or what I call the soul's reality, we go, oh, okay, that makes a certain amount of sense. You know, I can be both and. So I've yet to meet an ancestor that has declared, hey, I'm you and you're me. And maybe I will someday, maybe I won't. It doesn't matter to me. But what I am fascinated by is that we can reach. There's one that, if I may speak, let me check. Yeah, it's okay. There's an ancestor that I occasionally visit. And he's given me a story. His name, I have to clear it with him. Yeah, okay. And that seems a little weird, but I feel better if I clear it with him. His name that he gave me is Lotharian, which he lived in Ireland. At the time, he had a pretty large brood, great wife, big strapping sort of fellow is the image that I saw. And he lived a little bit outside of the main village. And that is not uncommon in shamanic cultures, is the shaman lives a little bit on the edge of the village. Somebody explained it this way, is that when people see the magic that occurs, the healing that occurs, and the magic that a shaman can create, co-create, they're a little bit wary, like, wow, if he or she can do this, then, oh, I better want to cross him, you know. I don't want to make him angry. I don't want to piss him off, you know. So they live on, let's put him on the edge of the village kind of a thing. It's possible that he fits that description of both being Lotharian as well as myself as an ancestor. It's possible. But I haven't, honestly, I haven't checked with him to see if that's the case or had that kind of experience.
Yeah, and I like too how you bring up that aspect of, you know, what the conscious mind and, you know, the rational thinking mind here that is rooted in this reality can conceive of versus the subconscious mind is not the same. And that's important to keep in mind, because sometimes, especially for anyone who's new to these topics, it might feel like, what, how is this possible, etc. But that's just it. There's just so much more for us to grasp than just what the rational thinking mind can. And so another big question that often comes up from many is, okay, so we see that we come through various parents or two various parents. If we are parents, then we have, you know, children and perhaps sisters, brothers, etc. And people often wonder, how does this work? What insight can you share about this in terms of coming through with the same or similar people playing different roles and how this ties into healing ancestral karma?
Yeah, you know, it's interesting because I mentioned earlier, and I said I'd get back to it, is something you could call soul's karma. And I would say that about what we think of as reality. There's this reality. You know, we got the electronics, the ability to do this, this chair, the concrete world, etc., the trees outside. And then there's this other reality. This is the key point, that's just as real as the physical reality that we're accustomed to, and we ordinarily think that's called the soul's reality. And we get to, we touch that when we tell stories, you know, teaching stories, when we have experiences, whatever they are that we maybe can't explain right away. When we go out and lay out under the stars and look at the Pleiades and go, ah, that's where we're from. Not physically, but our consciousness. Somebody asked me the other day, where are you from? I said, and I knew what he was asking, but I said, well, from Iowa. He says, no, you know what I mean. Where are you from? And I said, well, years ago in an initiation that took place on Cone Peak in the Big Sur wilderness, I was told that we're from the Pleiades. Now, we've heard this before, and frankly, I'm not a mystic, I'm a healer, but, you know, in shamanism, we deal with mystical realms. I went, I'll take that. Now, is that, can I prove it? Of course not. That's the soul's reality, for instance. You know, and you'll hear different versions of that, where we're actually from, or consciousness is from. So back to your question, Evita. I think that our soul, in addition to the genetic component, well, number one is we got two different sets of genes coming together. So there may be a selective process that we can't really deduce exactly how that happens. Why was my brother so such a social creature, you know, and I had the gift of gab, whereas me, I was a shy little kid. Well, they're different genes. First off, he had a different father, so that's part of it. But even if he had the same father, we had the same father and mother, they could come out in a different configuration. So that's part of it. The other is, I believe, that we come in with, you could say, our soul's destiny, our soul's karma. James Hillman wrote this book that years ago. There was one of those top 10 books, you know, that I read. And it was called Soul's Code, S-O-U-L, apostrophe S, the Soul's Code. And his premise was that just like the oak and the acorn and the oak, that we come in with a certain imprint, not just genetic imprint, but a soul imprint, that we have a certain destiny. And if you talk to people or think of your own story and what you're doing today in the world, you know, it makes a lot of sense. He spoke of one, I think it was Yasha Heifetz, a world-class violinist, said that when he was 3 years old, the story goes, he had asked for a violin. It's like something in him knew that he wanted to play the violin. Well, his parents, for Christmas, gave him a toy violin, a little tiny one that he could get his hands around. He got so upset with it that he smashed it because he wanted a violin. But he couldn't play it, but he wanted a violin. Something in him knew that. My own story, I'll give you one short story. My parents and I moved, my two brothers and sister, half-siblings, but that doesn't matter. My two brothers and sister had all moved out when I was 12. My dad, who worked construction, decided he's going to go to the land of golden opportunity, Southern California, because he couldn't get work in the winter. We get here. He was drinking a lot. My mother was getting crazy. You know, it was just a very stressful time. He couldn't get a job. He had to be in the union to get a job and had to have a job to get in the union, one of those catch-22s. At 13 years old, I sat my parents down. I said, listen, we got to talk. I sat them down, one chair over here, one chair over here, and counseled them at 13 years old. You know what my license, technically my license was in California? A marriage counselor, a marriage and family counselor. Now, there, in retrospect, it's obvious that there was something there that my soul was moving to. And again, you may even think in your own circumstance, you know, there might be experiences in your childhood, adolescence that really went, there's a hint of where I'm headed. You know, it may not be fully formed, just like the violinist, but you know, just like my story, you know, I became a counselor, you know, professional counselor eventually, and a healer. I'm not sure I did any good with my parents, by the way, but I gave it a shot. You know, I did my best at 13 years old.
Incredible. And this makes me think also of how very much if we pay attention to those signs, they could be small, they could be big, but that's the thing. They come through in our childhood, in our teens, and they continue. And something else that we'll be touching upon is, of course, how our living family members, as well as our deceased ancestors, can also help us and guide us. And you've beautifully illustrated some of that today, and also you share stories and such in your book. So when it comes to following our soul's path, how can we, you know, better connect on this? Because again, in our society, especially in North America, we seem to be very disconnected from ourselves, from nature, from our ancestors. Yeah. What can you shed on this topic?
Well, I like what you made some reference to, Evita, is as one opens to the awakening process, that the opportunity is there to start paying attention, well, pray, listen, pay attention to signs and symbols that show up in your dream state as well as your waking state. And one of the ways that I, you know, is one of my favorite ways, as you know from my works, is animals. Yeah. You know, I think they're exceptionally, they just do such an exceptional job of guiding us. And the teaching, in essence, is when an animal shows up in an unusual way and or repeatedly in a short space of time, there's something pretty big going on. That's whether it's the physical animal or a symbol, like in dreams, or the sound of an animal or somebody talking about an animal when it's repeated like that. And that is a fascinating area. People just take to it. You know, that's why I said earlier, that's one of the things I wanted to get out in the world more about animal spirit guides. And boy, I'll tell you, more and more people that have come up to me over the years and said this has been so helpful. And that's really my purpose. I'm not bragging about it. I'm just so pleased, you know, that it has been helpful. So that's one way, is to start paying attention to the signs and the symbols as one continues the awakening process. The other is certainly is to heal. Do what you whatever you need to do your healing. I don't care if it's therapy, counseling, going out in the woods, you know, doing a vision quest or a vision fast, going to a shaman, seeking healing at the spiritual core, the spiritual level. Doesn't really matter. That's what opens us to, how would I put it? You know, the best way I could think of it, Evita, is touching that deep ancestral memory of who we really are. I had a therapist years ago, great guy, God, he was so good for me, at a time when I was, one of my periods when I was kind of broken. And Paul Fairweather, what a great name, oh, Fairweather. And I was a little wiry guy, too. I remember he was probably all of about 5'7 or something like that, but he'd been a fighter pilot in the war, and so he had the whole warrior hero thing going on. But also very brilliant, brilliant man. And also very down to earth, I might add. But I spent about a year and a half with him in what I guess you'd call therapy. You know, it was mostly support. He looked at me one time, and he said, "Stephen," I remember his look, you know, kind of very intense look. He said, "Stephen, you know all this stuff that we do, therapy, counseling, encounter trainings and all that. I think it's just to help us remember who we really are." And I went, bingo. That's a story that stayed with me. And by that, Evita, I know you can appreciate it. It's remembering who we are at a core level. Sometimes I call it the deep ancestral memory. What that means to me is that we are part of our ancestors, and our ancestors are part of us, not just grandma, grandpa, but, you know, way back, you know, 1,000, 1,000,000, that we can access that deep memory of what it was like not to just live on the earth, but to live with the earth. And we're getting better at it. You know, there's good signs that we're getting better at it. And Mama, Madre, Pachamama, Earth Mother, the mother of us all, is doing a lot of adjusting right now in that dynamic, organic way that is sometimes a little threatening, sometimes kind of scary, sometimes absolutely exquisitely, I'd say most of the time, just beautiful. It's so beautiful just to walk out and see the trees. It's so beautiful to go up to a tree and feel the spirit of that tree, putting your back against the tree and just breathing and breathing with the tree. I give that as an assignment to my clients sometimes, to go out and just watch the stars, just look at the stars, to see the clouds moving. I'm in rapture here. I'll be back. Just remembering, you know, calling on that memory of what it's like to live with the land and with the earth. And, you know, we're working it. You know, we've gone quite a ways away from that, from an attitude that's been around for centuries of using the earth. The other thing I think that's fascinating to me is about, maybe up to 30, 40 years ago, we tended to think of indigenous communities and indigenous people as primitives. You know, we know much more, we're civilized, right? Right. And now we're going with our notepads to them and going, just, you know, want to tell us about this? And the other fascination is plants. This other African healer, Maladoma Somme, he says his Dagaro people that he's from, he says, "We believe there's three intelligences on the planet. The most intelligent beings are the plants." And I see a beautiful plant back there. "The most intelligent beings are the plants. The second most are the animals. Guess who got third place? We're looking at us right now." Anyway, it's a great telling because the plants do teach us. You know, we just pay attention. The animals do teach us, as I made reference to. And more and more people are interested even in finding these and discovering these shamanic realities, what you could call shamanic realities, that there is a force, you know, there's a life force in everything. And like animal spirit guides, it's not just the life force in the animal, but it's this animal comes to us representing the oversoul or the collective consciousness of that species. Wolf spirit's with me all the time, whether I'm aware of his presence or not. I know that I'm safe and protected at all times. That's a very close-in spirit animal called a power animal. It's been with me 20 years.
Wow, and I love that connection again with nature, with really ourselves, because we are nature, and that's the thing that we forget so often, especially in today's world, the busy, chaotic, mad rush that so many people live in, right? That there's so much wisdom, so much intelligence all around us, so many guides, so much support, but of course we have to be open to connecting with that first and foremost. Now, as we switch gears a little bit and approach it from also a very, you know, raw, practical level that touches many people's lives, as I shared at the beginning of our show today, is that many people, of course, do see various destructive and dysfunctional patterns within their families, and you know, they recognize them, and so often is the famous words, oh, I don't want to grow up like my mother, father, or whoever, or I don't want to continue this. And yet, you know, there seems to be this cyclical pattern. What can you share with people here in terms of how to help break these cycles?
I wish there were one simple answer for that, but I think there's a complexity to it in that everybody is if they just start paying attention, they're guided, you know, to certain ways of healing. For some, it may be more psychotherapy, for instance, or counseling. To talk to another human being in itself can be so healing. To have someone that you can sort of bare yourself to, and they're not going to judge you. You know, I cannot tell you how just compassionate listening when someone is troubled or suffering can itself be, it's so subtle, but it can be so healing just to have somebody else, or even just know that you're understood. That's one piece. The second is more actively seeking healing, which would be some of the methodologies that are available today to recover from trauma, from the post-traumatic effects. For instance, like I mentioned, referred to earlier, is there's ways that our instinct just naturally comes in to help us get through childhood. And there are some people who have come through just amazing, brutal kind of experiences and have come out just as healers. I know that I considered myself in one sense a wounded healer. In other words, I by my work to heal my own woundedness or the effects of the kind of traumatic experiences I had as a child, what I think it generated for me as I worked with the healing is a greater and greater compassion for others who suffered. Buddha said suffering's part of the deal. You know, when you're living in as a human being on this planet, if you stick your finger on a range that just had boiling water on it, you're going to get burned. It's just the way it is. But also the wounds that we suffer, particularly as a child when we're more vulnerable, we may not know quite how to get out of that until we're an adult and we can do the healing. I think finding a spiritual path or a spiritual discipline is really, really important. Some people find that in religion, which is fine. You know, they find solace and peace in that. One of my dear nieces is wrote a letter asking for help with this. She's going to Vietnam. She's part Vietnamese, and her grandma was, you know, Vietnamese, French Vietnamese. And she made a promise to her grandma when she died. She said, I'm going to go back to Vietnam. And her letter is so touching because she feels guided by God, you know, to do this. She's on a mission, 16 years old. Amazing, amazing. Not only her, but her sisters as well. So she's found a structure and a way of relating to the numinous and the oneness and God in that way. And I think that's great. Spiritual healing, some of the work that I've seen with the ancestral healing. My mother, God bless her, you know, I feel very at peace, and I've done a lot of work, you know, psychologically, etc., and psychotherapeutically with the healing of that, because I don't, she never saw me and never really got me. I'm not sure I could have been gotten, you know, because I had pretty shy and pretty walled up. I always thought I was a weird kid, and now I know I'm weird, but I'm okay with it, you know, and I get paid for it, so not bad. Weird in the sense of the usual norm. But she never got who I was. But I remember one time, it was an incidental thing where I went with my partner up to see her brother and sister-in-law trying to be a psychic. she gave me this reading that just like spiraled me down to this deep pain that was still there from the absence of a consistent quality or characteristic of love for my mother. And that's not a wham, wham, wham. It's just, it hits something very deep. Let's put it that way. I walked out of that reading just stunned. I was so overwhelmed with, sometimes when we're feeling things intensely and emotionally, it's like we shut down. And it was so intense for me that I shut down, basically. It was overwhelming. We go out to the woods. This is in Portland, Oregon, where you can go out about a half hour out of the city. And we're going to camp, my partner Cindy and I. And in the woods, I took out my journal, started writing, and just slowly, just kind of weeping about that, trying to process this whole experience and make sense of it. My mother came to me as if she were standing 3 feet away. And she said something that just still gives me, you know, chills. She said, "Oh, now I see who you are. Now I see you." And then I was like, you know, the floodgates open. But what a blessing to receive that kind of message that allowed me to feel compassion for her and compassion for myself. Not pity. I don't mean pity, but just compassion. That's a whole different deal. To be able to really to have that kind of compassion for our parents, you know, whether they're alive or they've died. To really release that so that it releases them too to go on.
Exactly. And that compassion is such an integral player in all of this, because that's just it. That's where our part of our healing, at least, if not, you know, a significant part of it lies. And, you know, in the book also you talk about the importance of things like validation and acknowledgement and forgiveness and understanding. And these are also going to be key players. And I'd love for you to perhaps talk a little bit about that as we actually to wrap up in the role that some of these tools, gifts, emotions can play for us, because there's many of us perhaps who are, you know, listening or joining in or will hear you speak that will be thinking of perhaps someone who has wronged us, or we feel they've wronged us or hurt us tremendously in the past, or perhaps, you know, we know that certain, again, pattern has been carried through our generations. For example, I've had a guest who had a cyclical history of suicide in the male lineage, the father, the grandfather, etc., and almost got to him as well. And so it's, you know, how to basically break those cycles and also to bring peace to ourselves, that deep healing, and also, as you shared too, that ancestral healing.
I could go on and on about that. I'll try to keep it short though, but there's, you know, a few different ways that one can do this. One is what comes to mind is an unsent letter. What that means is if you have a living relative that you're still got some energy on, I guess you'd say, is to write out just everything you want to say, your anger, your hurt, your pain, and then let it sit for a day and then burn it. And then if you want to, write the letter to that ancestor. That's one way. Another is to do a release ceremony. I'll sketch it real quickly here. What you do is you decide, make a choice as to what you want to release. We got the full moon coming up tomorrow too, so it's a great full moon is a great time to do a release, let go, fulfillment, etc. And that is to I now choose to release my self-destructive wishes. You know, for instance, like you mentioned with the person you talked with, and I'm almost oversimplifying it here, but you write this on a piece of paper. You go out on the land the day before. You find something that will help you release that, let's say a pebble. You take the pebble, piece of paper, put the pebble in the paper, and sleep with it that night. Say your prayers, ask the guides that you work with to help you dream into that, the energy of that which you're choosing to release. The night of the full moon, the next night, take that paper and the pebble out, preferably by a tree, in a very sacred way. Dig a grave. You know, and take the paper and the pebble, put it in the grave, burn it, bury it, and say thank you. And last but not least is an exercise I write about in the book, which is a way of working with the ancestors for the healing. And again, the setup is a little more involved than this, but basically finding amongst the previous three, choosing a condition, whatever it may be, let's say a physical condition, emotional condition, maybe I get depressed, let's call it depression. And then with the help of spirit, finding someone in the previous three generations particularly that has had that same issue of depression. And then you, with the help of, typically I use Archangel Michael or call on him, is to send healing love that he's channeling through you to this ancestor. The ancestor then takes and sends it back to you when it's complete so that you receive the healing in the now healed condition. And then you send it to your descendants. And then the completion is you whatever remains, you give it to yourself. And one short story that's, again, in the book is the first time I ever did this workshop and I did this exercise, this woman who had been there wrote to me and said, hey, I had a dream last night. And the dream was this, is I'm in the forest somewhere and I look in the distance and I see this fire and it looks like there's a group of guys around a fire. As I approached, the man whose back was towards me was my grandfather, I realized. He turned around to me and said, thank you. I can now sit in circle. Anyway, that's one telling of feedback I've gotten from this process. Another woman, I just did this recently up in Boulder, Colorado. And this woman that I saw individually the next day said, yeah, she said she had some physical condition. She said, I feel a lot better. You know, the jury's out, but I feel a lot better since we did that exercise. So those are some ways that you can mm-hmm. approach this, is to clearing. And whatever it is, seek the healing. You know, look for ways that you can heal. They're available. And trust your gut about the healer. Not all healers are, you know, have that kind of integrity, but you can have that kind of sense of what's right for you by trusting your gut, your intuition. You walk out of there and you go, didn't feel right. Trust that feeling. You walk out of there and go, yeah, I'm going to do another session here. We'll see. You know, counseling, shamanic healing, whatever it may be. So those are some examples, Evita.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you. And again, it gives us so many different options to work with, to know. But most important, again, it always comes down first to that awareness, right? That we allow ourselves to see and then to proceed with whatever, as you said, you know, that inner intuition, connecting with that inner guidance, and having discernment, conscious discernment, is so important here as well. And so thank you so much for sharing all that you have. And basically, to wrap up, I'd love for you to share any of your resources or anything in terms of how people can follow this path, as perhaps this is calling to them at this time, perhaps to look into your work further, some of the writing through the books, through your articles, perhaps through other videos. If you can start by sharing your website, any events, how people can get in touch with you, etc.
Yeah, earthmagic.net is the website. By going there, you're welcome to download articles. There's quite a few different articles that I've written about various things. Certainly the works I've made some reference to, you can find them there. Oh, we have, you know, a few other products too that you might be interested in, totem animals, that sort of thing. Also signing up for the newsletter once a month. We send out a newsletter, it tells you what I'm up to, where I'm going to be. I have a Earth Magic Practitioner training that's a certification program. We're going to start number 4 on May 26th in Southern California. It's a 9-month program, 4 meetings that you have to attend. Very intense, but the foundation for it is shamanic shamanism, basically, plus some other tools and technologies I've learned. But yeah, go to the website, earthmagic.net, and you'll find all my books and the oracle cards that I've helped create there. And I might put a plug in for one particular one, children's spirit animal cards. Mm-hmm. And also the CDs with the stories, those of you who have children, grandchildren. It's gotten got several awards from parent organizations and such. And you can work with them as far as children. My grandson at 2.5 was, you know, looking at the cards, just naming the animals, all the way to the parents that told me they go into their child's room at night, borrow the cards, they come out and they do readings with them. So, you know, check out those, the children's spirit animal cards. You can find them at, you know, the usual places, Amazon. My website, earthmagic.net, and elsewhere, New Age bookstores, etc. So my piece, let's see, words of wisdom. Words of wisdom, breathe. Good for you, breathe.
Thank you so much. That is wonderful. And I like too that you did mention your works with the kids material, because it's never too early to start, especially for those in the audience who are joining us as parents, regardless of how old or how young your kids are. This is really where it all begins. If we're going to be, you know, connecting as one and healing our own family and ancestral karma, and really just trying to, again, connect and be the best that we can be, and improve the quality of our lives and the lives of all those that we touch, then it really does start with every single one of us, including our children, and teaching them, you know, how to, of course, also connect and understand, whether it's nature, animals, plants, on that bigger, broader, more connected perspective. So thank you so much, Dr. Farmer, for being here with us today.
I enjoyed it thoroughly. Thank you for the work that you're doing in the world, what you're bringing to the community.
You're very welcome, and it is my deep pleasure, and also to share the works of people like yourself who are also enriching the lives of so many, bringing so much healing on a personal and collective level to our world, especially at this time. And so thank you also, everyone, for joining us today. If you have any questions, comments, or feedback, as always, feel free to leave them in the comment section below. Take care, and until next time.